I guess I want to start out with where Darrell and I met. I know a lot of people know, and I know that it sounds a little silly. Maybe it's just a wife story, but I don't really think it is. I think it was meant to be that Darrell and I met together, and both have a love of history for International Harvester. I had a business. He came in. He worked for the USDA, but he went home on the weekend to the farm. It was 2 hours away. And he came in and asked if he could work in the evenings. And lo and behold, that day, across my heart and hope to die, I had just gotten back my Alice Chalmers toy tractor that my son played with at the sandbox. And I had a friend that restored them. And it was a small business, same people every morning, every night, convenience store, kind of, every dog food, fast car, everything. And I was bragging to all my friends about how good they looked. They did look good. And when I was married the first time, we bought the 200 Alice. We didn't even own a house. And we bought a $20,000 tractor. I just couldn't believe a tractor. Now, $20,000 was like, yeah, like, whoa, that's just a drop in the bucket. But come to find out later on, he told me he thought that I knew that he collected toy tractors. And I had no clue that there were even people who collected toy tractors. I wasn't in that circle of people. I just collected them and saved them because I liked them. I know they were orange, but it kind of went down the same road. And then in our life, in our marriage, we did a lot of research on International Harvester. We both liked it, and I think that's where Dan and everybody's come up with the Darst family, because we ate, slept, and breathed International Harvester. And he worked for the USDA, I worked for my business, and then the post office, just to support our hobby. It was everything else with whatever, but I mean, you know, it was to support the hobby and carry it a little bit farther. We started out by the very first, he had a toy collection and I had a toy collection. And we went down to see a friend of mine in West Plains, Missouri, and he went because of me, and he sat there reading the ad finder and those little papers you pick up at the restaurant, and he found a W650, I think. I'm not real good on the tractors. But anyway, we bought it, and we went back down there and got it and brought it home, and he sold it to a man in New York. The man restored it. He still has it to this day. I can't remember his name, but every once in a while, we'll see him. And Darrell, that was one of his regrets, that he didn't keep that tractor, because we used the tractor money for our honeymoon. So, he said he should have kept the tractor and find out how to do the honeymoon. So other things that we did, oh my gosh, there are so many memories. It just is unreal. They all center around International Harvester. Darrell has a daughter, and I have three children, and we would go to tractor shows. Sometimes they weren't real excited about it, but I remember one year we went to Ohio, and he promised the kids that he'd take them to roller coasters in Sandusky, Ohio. Is it in Ohio, Sandusky?
Yeah.
Well, we got there because he drove all night long, so he didn't have tractor show, the roller coasters, and everything in between. We were in the parking lot at Sandusky at 5 in the morning waiting for the park to open. But they got to ride their roller coasters. We were so tired. He was tired. They were fine. They snuck all the way through the trip. But he would do things like that to make sure everybody got to do what they wanted to do. I would go to fishing shows. I went to one in Indianapolis because that was part of my business. American Rod and Gun Bass Pro. And I had to stay at the fishing show and, you know, buy worms. And him and Ashley would venture out. That's one of the times that Richmond, and she got locked in the car. She was about 5 years old. It's just a memory, you know, a memory. We researched all of the factories. We went to New Orleans, to the Twine Mill, which at this time, we're talking about the 80s. But we took pictures of all the buildings, and then he would do articles about it in the magazines. We went to Louisville, Kentucky, and took lots of pictures. He was always wanting to get some memento of that factory. And lo and behold, at the very end of our collection, in his days, he had lots of mementos. But when we went to Louisville, he said there was this little bar, and it was just about dark. And Ashley was probably about 4 or 5. So we stayed in the car, and Darrell went in, and he didn't come out, they came out. And I mean, I considered it, you know, not a very good neighborhood. It just wasn't. It was, you know, an old bar, and it was called The Harvester. Well, he went in, didn't come out, didn't come out, so Ashley and I finally went in, this whole time her for dear life. And he was over there drinking beers with a bunch of guys, and they were old employees of the Louisville plant. They were still going to the Harvester. Another time, when we went to research Wisconsin Steel, when we did this research, then we, you know, delved into the history of each company. And we went to Wisconsin Steel, there wasn't there wasn't anything left except just the maybe an old building or half of a brick wall. But, you know, we had bricks from everywhere. but he talked to a homeless man on the corner because there was a sign down there, Wisconsin Steel, that it was too big. And he couldn't get it off, and he wanted me to help him. What was that stoplight? I had a 5-year-old daughter. I said, what if they pick us up? I said, they'll take her, you know? So I said, you can come back. So he went back about a week later. But before he did, he went to the corner and gave the guy on the corner $10 to say, if you can get that sign off, we'll come back to get up and I'll give you a loan. Well, he went straight to the liquor store. So that never came back. But him and a friend went back up and got it. And, you know, in a small way, Darrell didn't let me tell her about that because he said, well, that sounds like you stole it. And I don't know. I don't really think he did. It would have been bulldozed and it would have been at the bottom of the Great Lakes if somebody wouldn't have took it. What, it wasn't a pretty sign. It was just a sign because it was not a seal. Other things we did, I know one year on New Year's Eve, we took off and went to Southern Missouri. We found a cop picker and a 300. I'm doing all this by memory. The 300 with a Continental engine. And he had a terrible time finding parts for that. I should have took more notes. Mm-hmm. I have a few more things that I'll think of along. But I want to tell you, since I moved to Wisconsin after Darrell passed away, International Harvester, it's so thick in the Wisconsin, Chicago, and Northern Illinois area. I've never experienced it. And I went to get an EKG done, and the man doing the EKG, I said, are you from a farming background? Well, yeah, kind of, sorry. I said, when I was young, I worked at an International Harvester dealership. Well, I mean, then it went, you know, crazy. And I said, oh my gosh, you know, he's doing an EKG and we're talking tractors. But I got him some magazines. He never even knew about the club. He had no clue there was a club. So I got him some magazines. And then I went to Home Depot here about 2 weeks ago to get dirt. And I was backing out, and in my rearview mirror there was a travel log. I mean, restored mint. It was beautiful, just gorgeous. And I was backing out thinking, I gotta get over there and talk to this guy. So I went over, I backed out and went over there because I sure as heck couldn't run. Mm-hmm. And he had restored it. He didn't know there was an International Harvester Club. He had heard that there was going to be a show down at Quoin, but he had no clue there was a club. And then we went to a, I know we're not supposed to mention the parade, is there anybody in here? Don't tell, okay? Because we can't have parades in the magazine. And insurance purposes, you know how that is nowadays. But we went to a golf cart parade where I moved, and that's the reason I moved there, because I have a golf cart right along the lake with my kids, which are Jack and Lucy and Ellie, my dogs. And we pulled in, my son-in-law was with us, future son-in-law, because he was thirsty at the little bar and grill. And he jumps out to go get a beer, and this couple pulls in next to us. It was a brother and sister on a Holzman Highboard. And I said, oh my gosh, it is so cool. And not even, I had forgotten the companies that International, you know, gobbled up back in the early 1900s. And he said, he was in a hurry, he was really thirsty. He didn't even really want to talk, and I just kept talking. And Ashley is after me on that. But anyway, I said, when did they go out of business? And he said, 1909. He said, but after that, the International Harvester bought. So they took and they got hold of Holzman, and they were the first company to come up with rear gears. So International Harvester took it. I guess they got that from them. But I mean, after he said International, and I said, that's really neat. And I said, I still do the magazine. I mean, he opened the trunk to that little thing in the front, which was a little small trunk. He had pictures. He had certificates from the company or the past company. There must be an organization with his name on them. And I mean, he got excited about it. There's just international people everywhere, and they're all like family. That's why this is the first time I did go to the winter convention, but Ashley was with me. By the way, Ashley didn't work. And, but this is the first time I've been solo. And it's a different experience, but you see friends and people that you haven't seen for a long time. It seems like you see them once and or twice. And Darrell and I have been doing this for 25 years. So everybody in the club, they're just like family. I tell you what, I'm really nervous. And I just can't think of all the stories I can tell you. And I thought of them. I lay in bed at night to think about them. But they're not coming to me real well. But I think the reason, I wanted to go in the magazine. I guess everybody knows that we sold out the museum.
Yeah.
You
went on the
better. Ron, get to work. This is a picture of my refrigeration display. We took it to Tennessee about 15 years ago. Has anybody ever, did they ever know Bill Grocop out of Indiana? Then he moved to Pennsylvania. He was an early, early collector. And we met him at the very beginning of collecting. He collected stuff that, maybe that's one of the reasons Darrell collected what he did, but the curtains and the signs. And just like the bricks from, you know, a building, just the history of the company and the history of the people. His father had an international dealership, and he passed on really early in his early 50s. And there's two or three items in there that we got from Bill. Well, I'll tell the story about the Tracto. The Tracto came from Darrell Darst. He told Darrell, he was living in Pennsylvania in a neighborhood, and not on a farm, he didn't have any tractors. He was just collecting small memorabilia. And Darrell wanted to know if he could get this in Tracto. Well, there's only one Tracto left. He had done some research and said there were two, but one of them got part it out. But does anybody know who Tracto is? Well, he's over in the exhibit hall. And I love leading to all those auctions. And they're taking very good care of him. He's so happy because that tractor robot gave me so much heartache right after Darrell passed away. I was just worried about him because he was like part of the family. But anyway, when Bill told Darrell, he was at an old Ford dealership in the suburbs of Chicago. And I never really understood the suburbs of Chicago, but now my daughter lives in Vernon Hills. And it's just like town, you know, they're not really suburbs. You know, it's just one right after the other. But we went up there with the two girls. Marsha was about 12 or 13, and Ashley was about 5, and picked him up, and he put him in the back of the pickup, and he was a mess. He was painted Ford blue. So we would stop at a little, we went up to her apartment, and I was just asking her about how she got to work for International, and why she went to work for International, and she was telling me all these things, and she said, well, I've got some papers from when I worked there. And she had her apartment wasn't very big, it was just an assisted living. And she opened up her filing cabinet drawer, and she brought out two files, maybe about a half inch thick each one. And on the very top of it, written in pencil, it was really faded because it was really old. And she had written on there, International Harvester Memories. And she kept those through all these years because she said it wasn't just the job, it was the people and the life and the company, and she just loved the job. But she was there to experiment with food, see what would freeze, what wouldn't freeze. After you froze it and you ate it, was it going to kill you? You know, she was right at the very beginning. Her and her education, she was adopted, and she went out. Her first job was at Farmall Works, and then from Farmall Works, she went to the Home Economics Division. But she was always in, you know, the home economy part. But she got to be the head of home economics. And she did give me a pamphlet that she had saved, and it was all of the officers of the company. And I didn't bring any of that. I kept all of that. I didn't sell that. Because to me, that's memories, you know, but I don't want to part with that yet. And all these, there's like 10 pictures of people, you know, their job titles, you know, they've got Brooks and Harvey is on there. And she's on there. Ruth Whiting, home economist. And it was so funny because she said, see that camera? Those are all men. See me? I'm there. And that was, you know, back in the 40s. And she was so proud that she was right there with all you guys. we did tour the Evansville plant. When it was Whirlpool, and they took us, a man took us through there, which I wrote them and called and asked if we could come see the plant, and they were just like dumbfounded. Why would anybody want to come in here and see they were producing Whirlpool refrigerators? Oh, one more thing about Ruth. After she went in, she left International Harvester, and when she did, she went to Frigidaire, and I said, do you have, you know, anything from Frigidaire? And that was just a job. You know, and that was exactly how she put it. International was her life, and working at Frigidaire was just a job. But we went to the Evansville plant and toured it, which it was Whirlpool, but got to see the offices and things like that. It just brings you back to think about how it could have been. And about 3 weeks later, got a package in the mail, and the guy that gave us a tour, he cut out one of those wooden blocks off the floor and sent me a block. Wow. So that came out of the plan. sure that a lot of people have looked at us and thought that maybe, you know, we're a little over the top. Another thing is Daring, if anybody has heard of Daring, Missouri, there's a town, and it was patterned, it was before, because the person, Daring owned it, and then when they merged, then it became part of International, but that's where Daring got all of his wood and everything for all the horse-drawn equipment, all the equipment. But we went to Daring, Missouri, and Darrell was instrumental in getting the plaque put up, you know, the historic site of Daring, Missouri, and it's still there to this day. But in the meantime, like I said, we would go around and ask questions, and we went to the Historical Society, and we met a lady, her name was Ophelia Wade. I can't remember her husband's name, but her son's name was Kevin, because at that time he had season tickets to the Cardinals, and he was the head of the season, or just tickets at the stadium, and I thought, yeah, right, you know. I think the next time we got correspondence from them at the bottom, it was signed Kevin Wade. Wow, he really was. But anyway, her husband and her, they traveled to every single stadium in the United States, and they wrote a book about it. But the way Ophelia was important to Daring was she was researching the history of it too. And the same thing happened in Hinsdale, because we went to all the, a lot of their historical meetings, and not maybe Hinsdale, the town itself, you know, would have been more involved in International Harvest here because of the experimental aspect of Hinsdale. And that's where we got turned on to Alexander Leahy, or Leahy, whichever way. How do you say it? Leahy.
Leahy.
Yeah. But anyway, and then, you know, his wife, and they never had any children, and there was a memorial historical site right there in Hinsdale. It's still there. We went, and his wife and him are both buried there, I believe. And they took care of a lot of the women out of factories and offices and stuff. They played tennis and had meetings, and that was part of her contribution to International Harvester. Another town was Benham, Kentucky. Oh my gosh. Darrell just on a fluke, he was reading it. It came from, we were out in Arizona, we were up there researching the test track, and Benham come up, because the coal mining, you know, in International had a separate train track that meant that they were right next to a U.S. steel mine, but we went out there to investigate on that. Didn't have a clue what we were going to find. Walked into this little convenience store, and this is what makes International Harvesters so interesting. Just all of those side stories, and it seems like people that were involved with International Harvesters, I mean, they actually truly love their jobs. I mean, it's like my dad delivered 7-Up for 40 years. I mean, I wouldn't allow him to drink a Pepsi because he got a house. You know, but anyway, we went there, just a little convenience store, just asked questions, and there was a group of ladies, an oblong table, maybe 5, 6, 7, 8, and Darrell asked about International Harvester, and oh my gosh, that turned the button. And they were called the Petticoat Mafia. That was the name of their club, Petticoat Mafia. And in Benham, if you ever get a chance to go through Kentucky and one of those side trips, it is well worth the trip. There's a Loretta Lynn Museum there, a little convenience store, which I don't know if they've got anything international in there, but there's the theater, the doctor's office, the high school, I mean, all this stuff that was owned by International Harvester. And you can look down the block and you see the same houses going up the hill, and those were all owned by International Harvester and set out for their employees. And but they just loved their, oh, the firehouse, then down the road from that, well, oh, a quarter mile, half mile was the mine itself. And of course, Darrell had to go through the mine, and he brought a piece of coal. You know, he wasn't supposed to, but we had a piece of coal too from the men of the mine. So, trying to think, I know I haven't touched on all the little places that we've been and things we did, but I guess you can see that the love of history. And that's why that toy tractor way back when really meant something, because who would have thought that I liked what he was going to do, you know? And we did it together. I think we did it together. I don't know. So I wanted to, he started, the magazine was from the beginning of the club, and Mike Androvich started out with a newsletter, and it was a new club. Oh, and I was going to say something, I'm looking at you, Bill. I asked Ruth to go to the club, Ruth Whiting, the first home economics. I begged her to go. I wanted her to go so bad in that red suit. And, you know, she had a speech impediment, and she was really embarrassed about that. But she couldn't believe that people were actually out there at the Winter Convention, the International Harvester. But Bill's from around that area. That's what made me think of it. But anyway, the magazine, when Darrell took it over, yeah, would you? Thank you. This is one of every magazine that he did. There's 24 years, four times a year. I don't think he ever missed one. If I am missing one in here, I don't know, maybe he didn't do that long, or that quarter, but I don't think so. I think I'm just missing it. But if anybody wants to look at it, show you the first one. Has anybody ever seen the first one? Well, this is what I was going to do, but I was late. So, I'm in the process of I'm going to go through and label and make a master list of each article that's in each magazine. So somebody can go back through and say, oh, that article was such and such. And Darrell didn't write all the articles, but he did a lot of history. This is the beginning. This is the very first one by mine. And then the second by mine. We did. Or no. Wasn't 97. I'm wrong. Yeah, it was 97. But yeah, mine just did the president's letter because he was president of the club. That's what happens when you're the president. You get drafted. Right, Bill? And then it went to this. And this, when we did it, this was more of a newsletter. We'd do this. And we would take it, put it on the kitchen table like this, and we would cut and paste everything. You just cut and paste. It was a real job. But we didn't know any better. We thought that's what you did. So we did that. Here, oh, this was another, he went down here and the Hobson plantation. Cotton plantation down south. And the Iron Man, does anybody know who the Iron Man is? Yeah. Well, if I run across him here, maybe I can tell you. But he was International Harvester. I think he was maybe one of the founders, or I'm not sure. Here is a picture of when we did the dairy town of Missouri chapter. I mean, anyway, it's gone a long way, and Darrell really loved doing the magazine. I can't say later years, you know, sometimes, you know, every 3 months it get a little harder, but he liked doing the magazine. And I've taken it over. That's a picture of my Darrell Wayne on his tractor right there. I love that picture. He wasn't, he could smile a lot, and smile most of his eyes. I think a lot of you can smile with your eyes. But I wanted to show you some of that. I know I'm not organized, but on our collection, we didn't just collect, you know, every cigarette lighter there was. And we like that. It's just that we like the unique and one-of-a-kind things, just like a captain's hat from the ship. We went up to Sault Ste. Marie, too, and saw where the ships went through, just on the fact that that's where some of them went through. He got a captain's hat, and he researched the plane, and I haven't gotten rid of these either, because he would wear this all the time. It's the wings, the pilot, and it's, you know, what he would wear on his uniform. And I don't know of any, I've never heard of another one of these, but it's got IH on there. And we both got, I more than him, but we both got involved with the McCormick family and just the history of the family. And somebody help me out. What's the name of that new book that just came out within the last year? It was out of Pennsylvania, so it's probably been 2 years. Regular, no, it's not a tractor magazine, it's about the family and the International Harvester. It's yellow and kind of a light blue on the top. Shamhorn is the author's name. Beat myself up when I remember that. But that is the best book. If anybody's got it around here and a stand, buy it. And read it, because I could not put it down. It just goes from A to Z on the McCormick family, the good and the bad and the ugly. And, you know, they were philanthropists, but I can't say that word either. But they were more involved in bettering the religious organizations and Chicago, almost it seemed to me, than it was to build a tractor. It was kind of like tractors. Tractor with a job, all this other stuff, you know, that contributed to them being able to do the other things that they wanted to do. One of the pieces I've got, I one of a kind, and I had a friend who was an antique dealer, and but the 100th anniversary of the International Harvester, you know, the big coins, then you have the little coin, and the other coin, and the real little coin, and they're all gold. Well, Lee from the archives, anybody remember Lee? Yeah, I know the old collector, the old international people do, but he looked up some information for me to make sure it was correct, but they gave out, I think about 8 or 10 of these to all the officers of the company and each and every family member. So Nettie got one, Brooks, Stanley. I always say Stanley because I read about Stanley and he was a mess. The daughter got one, Anita McCormick Lane. And I have her coin, and to think to me that woman held this coin, you know, she was family. And it's authentic, it's got her name is imprinted on the side, Anita McCormick Lane, and I think we've got the original case, but the antique dealer, Diane, she from Mendota, Illinois, she saved it for me to see if I would want it. And of course I did. I said, yeah, I want it. And then I asked how much it was. But it doesn't matter. It was worth it. Because it belonged to the family. And I wish the family could get a hold of the coin and be with the family again. But I don't know if the family ever thought there's such a good international harvester as the employees did. But anyway, I guess I can't think of anything else. I hope I haven't bored people too much. I try not to, but I start talking about international harvester, especially when I talk about the family.
Kevin,
I'm sure
you haven't bored anyone. I personally have a question. I've talked to Darrell and you conducted many interviews. You did a lot of research and met a lot of people. Now, can you reflect just for a moment to some of the most significant, most interesting, or whatever people that had an opportunity to meet or discuss with or some research you did? Just kind of share some of that. So,
well, I mean, like Ed Gall. Right here instead of me. And by the way, I'm doing this for him, not for me. Because I would like people to remember that Darrell really did care for international. Tried so hard from the very beginning with the club for it to prosper and not be a money-making or a, just like I show you my coin. I don't show you this to say, hey, I got this coin. You don't. The bragging and everything, sometimes that goes too far. But he just truly cared for the company. And like I said, I'm doing this for Darrell and his love of IH and mine too. But that's why I'm here. And if anybody wants to, and as far as people go, Dan, I don't know. We went up to the Hamilton plant. We met the CEO of the company that was up there. And what did they produce? I forgot, but that was quite a trip.
Greenville's up there. Anybody have any idea about articles or anything?
Well, if not, I know we all appreciate you coming here, and we certainly appreciate all the things that Darrell and the family have done.
Well, I wish I would more to the next, but I'm not.
Well, the fact is, you've already contributed in the past, and I appreciate what you're